Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal,
have mercy on us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
God, we cry out to you.
You are the Holy One, and we put our trust in you.
God, we cry out to you.
You deliver us from sin and shame and death.
God, we cry out to you.
Our lives since birth have been entrusted to you.
God, we cry out to you.
Be not far, for trouble is near.
God, we cry out to you.
Our strength is gone. We are poured out like water.
God, we cry out to you.
Hear us. Come quickly to our aid and save us.
A reading from Luke. Two others also, who were criminals, were led away to be put to death with Jesus. When they came to the place that is called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing. Who are these soldiers? The ones who arrest Jesus, mock him, and crucify him. Maybe we think of them as the representatives of an occupying force in Judea. Maybe we think of them as cruel. Or maybe we think of them just as cogs in the great machine that seems to grind every year on this Good Friday toward the horrible death of Jesus. But they too are people, aren't they? People perhaps with families or who want to have families, people with their own hopes, dreams, aspirations, people who wanted the adventure of the soldier's life, perhaps, or those who just couldn't wait to get back home. They perform acts of cruelty on a regular basis. They perform this very particular act of cruelty to Jesus. It's their job, yes, just following orders, but they fail to stop and step back and say no to harming this human being in front of them. They fail to say no to who knows how many human beings before this one and after this one. They bear some responsibility for their actions. And yet, from the cross, Jesus proclaims, "Father, forgive them." At the same time, they are part of this system they cannot entirely separate themselves from, even if they tried. They could say no. They could refuse to crucify Jesus. Perhaps some did refuse along the way. I doubt those who did fared very well in a system designed to perpetuate the status quo, a system designed to keep certain people in power. To say no might simply have put them on the very crosses they were putting others on. It doesn't excuse their failure to say no, but it does say that if they didn't crucify Jesus, someone else was going to. Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. All of them. None of them, that is, quite know what they are doing. But then isn't that our life as well? People who sometimes commit acts of cruelty. People who, despite our best intentions, who despite the excuses we make for ourselves, sometimes perpetuate harm on others. People who justify our complacency with the excuse that if we don't, someone else will. People who, despite our best efforts, cannot overcome the systems that oppress others, the systems that keep people in poverty, the systems that perpetually exclude and even kill those whose skin color or gender identity or immigration status isn't the one in power. Aren't we those people whose sometimes all too meek no to those systems lands us in the spot of those soldiers? Perhaps we hear Jesus' words, "Father, forgive them," and think that Jesus is speaking a word of understanding, releasing them even from the guilt, even excusing the horror of what is happening for the larger purpose at hand. Perhaps we hear Jesus speaking the very real truth that they don't understand the cosmic implications of what's happening in this moment with Jesus on the cross. But I wonder that this is a different kind of statement from Jesus. A statement that he speaks not so much as a way of letting these soldiers off the hook, but as a way of inviting them into the resurrection. The forgiveness that Jesus speaks to them, the forgiveness that Jesus speaks to others throughout the Gospels, the forgiveness that Jesus speaks to you and to me is not an easy get-out-of-jail-free card, but a life-transforming invitation to a life lived from a place of bold grace. It's an invitation, yes, to let go of the shame for what we have done, but more importantly, to live from the place of a new resurrection world. It's an invitation to the liberation that they need, those soldiers and you and I, that they need just as much as the people they have oppressed. It's an invitation to liberate everyone from the mire of injustice, cruelty, and harm that perpetuates itself anew in every generation. That's what Jesus is doing on the cross and in resurrection, speaking that firm no to systems of injustice and violence, bearing the consequences of that refusal to participate in those systems, and ultimately proclaiming the power of God's love, God's forgiveness, God's liberating resurrection life that is more powerful than those systems that bind the soldiers and the systems that bind us. Jesus speaks to us from the cross, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." It does not excuse us from our wrongdoing. It does not excuse us from the wrongdoing that we do bound up in the bigger systems, but it does boldly and unquestioningly invite us into the liberation that Jesus proclaims and enacts from the cross for all life, for us, and for all creation. Amen. Bless you. Oh, a prayer, sorry. Let us pray. God of all joy, fill our souls to overflowing with the fullness of your grace. On this day, remind us of your triumph over the tragedy of the cross and your victory for us over the powers of sin and death, so that we may reflect your glory as disciples of Jesus Christ, our risen Lord. Amen.
Great God in Christ, your Son. A reading from the Gospel of Luke, the 23rd chapter. One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation? And we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." He replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. I wonder how much the two thieves beside Jesus knew about him. If they heard about Jesus' ministry, his healing, drawing thousands to him as he spoke, forgiving and loving those who everyone said Jesus shouldn't love. Or maybe they only knew Jesus as a rebel rouser, a man who started a movement that questioned the status quo and pushed against the powers that be. Or perhaps all they knew about him was what they overheard that day. The shouts of the crowd as Jesus was put on trial by Pilate. The jeers of the Roman soldiers as they beat him. The shocked and grief-stricken faces of some standing on the streets as all three of them walked and carried their cross to Golgotha. As they walked to their death, everything must have felt hopeless. Maybe as they sat in jail, maybe there was some hope that something would change their conviction. But the day was here, the day they were going to die. And they just so happened to be crucified beside a man who people are calling the Messiah. A man who people were expecting him to overthrow the Roman government. Not that he too would be put to death by the very government he was supposed to overthrow. One of the men beside Jesus said, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and us." I hear that as a jeer and as a jab, making fun of Jesus. But I also hear desperation in his voice. Someone who is about to die and is afraid. If this man, Jesus, is able to turn water into wine, heal the blind, feed 5,000, he could save us. This man was desperate to be saved, and it turns out he's going about it all wrong. The man on the other side of Jesus, though, he seems to get it. He sees Jesus' innocence, that he did nothing to deserve to be in this situation. He seems to have found a bit of peace in his own fate too, accepting this as a consequence to his actions. But in one of the hopeless places that we can possibly imagine, this man finds hope. He sees that there's something next for him. Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. Jesus, remember me. And Jesus does. This man's hope turns into an open door into eternal life. Not out of this man's own merit, but out of the abundant love of God that's for him, that's for you, that's for us. Truly, I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise. There, in the midst of death, new life is found. A promise is made. And that same promise is for each of us, that one day we too will join Jesus in paradise. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, remember us, we pray. Remember us now, today, and remember us when you come into the fullness of your kingdom. Thank you for the promise of the cross, the promise of paradise, the promise of your presence, and how that promise is for each of us too, that we too will be with you in paradise. Amen.
A reading from John. Now the cross of Jesus, near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, the disciple took her into his home. The word of the Lord. At Zion, we are doing a midweek series called Created for Community. It is based on the early church when catechumens prepared for baptism on the Easter Vigil. But it wasn't a solo experience. It wasn't about the catechumens being on their own as they prepared, but the whole community supported them as they prepared. My assumption is that the community wanted the catechumens to be part of the community, and they were excited to welcome them. I have thought about this much during Lent, and it has given me a new perspective on Lent. I have generally seen Lent as kind of a solo experience, what I give up, what I take on, the sins that I confess, the forgiveness I received. We do experience that. We hear the phrase, my personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And I can't count the number of times I've heard people say, my personal relationship with Jesus, or I go to church for myself. Well, there are many times that Jesus has a one-on-one encounter and interactions with people. The first thing he does is call people to go with him. Most of what Jesus does is in community. Several commentators on this passage talk about this is about Jesus making sure that his mother is taken care of. That is certainly important. A child would want to do that for their parent, especially in a place where women did not have rights or powers, especially when a woman would be grieving the loss of her child. But I wonder when Jesus says, "Here is your son and here is your mother," is this about making sure that the mother and disciple whom he loved were both taken care of, that they would be in community, not just one taking care of the other, but caring for each other? And if that is the case, can we believe that Jesus is reminding all his loved ones, all his disciples, all in his community, to care for one another after his death? That community is important. Community was important to Jesus. Relationships were important to Jesus. And if we are looking at these seven last words as thing that Jesus wanted to be sure we heard before he died, then maybe that means that in his death and resurrection we have community. A community we entered in our baptism, and the relationships continue to be important to Jesus, and community continues to be important to Jesus. Amen. Let us pray. Dear God of community, in the days of old, the community rallied around the catechumens, those joining the community. Jesus brought people into community. In these days, help us to be in community with one another and welcome into our community those who are in need and long for community. Help us to seek out the lonely, the lost, the disenfranchised, and welcome them into our community of Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
From the 22nd Psalm. From noon on, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. And about 3:00, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani?" That is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" People who've worshiped in my church have heard me tell this story. But those who haven't heard it, I think it's one worth repeating. Many years ago, 20 to be precise, the church at which I then worked as director of Christian education put on a production of the wonderful Stephen Schwartz musical, Godspell. In fact, our church's musician, Eric, was a teenager in that church back then and actually coordinated the music for this production. Now, our church had a balcony, and in the front row of that seating area were a man who was a church member seated with his young son, probably not more than 5 years old. If you've ever seen Godspell, and if not, I suggest that you do, you would remember that it's really a joyful, upbeat production. But since it tells the story of Jesus, there does come a point in the show when things get downright depressing, as Jesus' closest friends come to realize that he's about to be killed, crucified upon a cross. I'll never forget what I heard from that voice in the balcony that night, the voice of a young child who'd been totally absorbed in this tale centered around this amazing man, Jesus of Nazareth. As he watched these scenes of impending rejection and ultimate crucifixion unfold, the boy turned to his dad and in a voice audible to the hundreds packed into the church that evening, asked a pretty darn profound question. "Daddy, why are they doing this?" he said. "Why are they being so mean to so nice a man?" The man of whom he was speaking, of course, it was Jesus. As he hung on that cross on this Friday we now call Good, Jesus had a question too. It was a question he plucked from the words of the ancient psalm of his people, the people of Israel, Psalm 22. Suffering from intense pain, up on the cross, Jesus verbalized, he articulated the questions so many of us down through the generations have asked. Why do bad things, often terrible things, all too often happen to those who seek to do what is right? Why does a good God, a God whom we are taught to believe loves that which that God has created, why does a good God allow the innocent to suffer? In our lifetimes, we've heard that question spoken. We may have asked it ourselves, as we've read of earthquakes or floods wiping out the homes of impoverished people, as we've witnessed on our TV screens visuals depicting children dying of malnutrition, as we've become increasingly aware of the pervading presence of injustice that constitutes the reality of life in this, the space we inhabit, the space we call God's world. Many great thinkers have raised these questions. Why do bad things happen? Why do the innocent suffer? Why does a God whom we call good allow this? Many have constructed answers, sometimes elaborate answers, answers that all too often fail to satisfy. But you see, my friends, on this Good Friday, as we think about Jesus up upon that cross, I would suggest we consider these two things. First, that we acknowledge that God is mystery. God is mystery, and we don't know the answers to so many of our questions about God. I remember an insight I once had. Someone from a church I had served as pastor had died, and from my conversations with her throughout the time in which I knew her, I was so deeply impressed by how much she loved God and how much she wanted to know about God. When she died, I felt awful because I knew what kind of person she was, and I appreciated those questions. She really cared, and to me, that was an inspiration. So I had her and her death on my mind as I went through the day when I first learned she had died, when at one point a thought just popped into my mind, a thought I'll share with you. It was one that came out of nowhere, at least that's what I thought. It dawned on me, as I considered her recent, fairly sudden death, that right now, as I was thinking about her death, I was struck by the fact that she already knows a lot more about the mystery that's God and everlasting life than I do. Despite the number of degrees in theology I might have, even though she never came anywhere near taking the classes I did or reading all those books about God, the Bible, or Jesus that sit on my bookshelves at church or at home, in her transition from this life to a life unknown to our experience, she came face to face with the mysterious God revealed to us in the life and, yes, the death of this man on the cross, Jesus of Nazareth, the one we call the Christ, he who, in the full expression of his humanity, cried out to God with words of pain and anguish, all summarized in that simple word, why. My friends, this psalm Jesus prayed speaks to our lives, doesn't it? It speaks to our encounters with the mysterious, with the unjust, with the painful. These words are gut-wrenching ones, asking of God, why have you abandoned me? Why have you left me to hang on a cross? Psalm 22, from which these words come, is a long one, but one I suggest that you read today or tonight. And as this message of mine now ends, I offer all of us the final words of that psalm that Jesus knew so well, words that led to a question, why, yet moved to this stirring conclusion. Hear now the last words of Psalm 22, the psalm Jesus remembered as the powerful psalm of his Jewish faith, the psalm which gave him words as he died upon the cross. For dominion belongs to God, and God rules over the nations. To God indeed shall all who sleep in the earth bow down. Before God shall bow all who go down to the dust, and I shall live for him. Posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord and proclaim God's deliverance to a people yet unborn, saying that God has done it. Amen.
Cross. be true. It's shame and reproach gladly bear. Then he'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share.
Knowing that everything had been accomplished, that scripture might be fulfilled, he said, "I thirst." Many of us who are watching this video today have had the privilege to go and drink water whenever we want. You can go to your sink or go to your refrigerator and have a nice cold glass of water in just a few minutes. In fact, I am sure that there are many of us who say we don't even like water. We'd rather have lemonade or soda or coffee or tea. But there has been some point in our life when we have been thirsty. We've had that parched feeling. We need a drink of water. Maybe it was after a long walk outside or after a strenuous workout. We say that we are thirsty, and then we start to feel it within ourselves. But the thirst of Jesus on the cross is simply unimaginable. His body thirsts for water. Not only is his mouth dry, but his whole entire body aches from abuse. His body longs for water, and his soul thirsts for love. Jesus at this point thirsts for the love of God, which he cannot feel. Instead, he feels this disconnect from God because he is suffering. His body is starting to shut down. He knows that God is still there, but he can't feel it. He feels this disconnect from God. We know that God loves us, but like thirst, there are times when we feel disconnected from God. But God continues to love Jesus. The Holy Spirit continues to support Jesus. I believe Jesus knows that the Holy Spirit is with him, but at this point on the cross, he cannot see her. He might not be able to feel her spirit with him. But where the Holy Spirit moves, there is the pulse of life. Where the Holy Spirit moves, the unclean are cleansed. Where the Holy Spirit moves, the dry ground is watered and living things start to grow. But all Jesus can think about right now, all Jesus can feel right now is his pulse giving out. His body is torn to shreds. His tongue is dry as desert sand and he thirsts. In these two simple words, "I thirst," we are a witness of the humanity in Jesus. We are brought in with the suffering that he experiences. Jesus has poured himself out for us, and there is nothing left for him to give, and he thirsts. And it reveals the universal need that all of us have, because we need water. We cannot live without it. Wars has been fought over the rights of water. It is necessary for survival on this planet, so we can all identify with Jesus as he thirsts on the cross. Jesus is the source of the living water. And now he cries out with desperate thirst. The water he offers is salvation, it's cleansing, it's eternal life. The Holy Spirit is flowing with inside of him. The water he offers provides peace and hope and rest. I thirst reveals a universal source. Jesus was forsaken on the cross so that we would never be forsaken. He bore our sins so we could be forgiven of our sins. He died on the cross so we can have eternal life. He thirsts in order that our thirst, our soul, could be forever satisfied. Jesus' thirst points to our source of eternal life. It's not just a cool sip of spiritual water to help us through a bad day. It's a spring of water, of living water, that provides life for us all, that provides hope and peace, both now and forever. Amen. Dear God, thank you for being with us, and thank you for giving us the resources to satisfy our physical thirst and our spiritual thirst. Be with those who long to have their needs met, that we may be a resource of positive change, and that we can feel and experience and enable others to feel and experience the Holy Spirit in her glory. We pray this in Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with us, now and forever. Amen.
From John's Gospel, chapter 19, verse 30. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." years ago when I was visiting a convalescent home, chatting with an elder woman who was living there, she began to tell me all about her adult son, who, I would say, was going through a pretty significant bad season of troubles, afflictions, and she was frankly very worried about her son. As a matter of fact, she was beside herself with worry, and after I just listened and she spoke about him, at the end of it all, and we prayed, she said, "Well, a mother's work is never finished." And I remembered as I went out to the parking lot, still thinking about what she had said, it felt to me, frankly, like a kind of prophecy, because at the time I was a young father. A mother's work, a dad's work, is never finished. Today, we are thinking about Jesus' seven last words, and this last one from John's Gospel is where Jesus says, "It is finished." And we could say that his lordship is never finished. We don't understand this to mean that he is done loving us, because elsewhere in the Gospel it has said, "Having loved us, he loved us to the end." So what does it mean then when he says, "It is finished"? What is it? And what is finished? I actually feel pretty passionately about what I think I understand about this verse and just want to share something about that. I'm going to make the case that it is different than what I might have thought. Matthew and Luke, in their tellings of this same narrative, make a point that Jesus was speaking at this point in a loud voice. And from that, many people have concluded, I think rightly, that when he says it is finished, it is not a white flag of surrender or resignation, of weakness, but something different, rather something more like completion, even victory. It is finished. Now look, I half-time am a grammar teacher, and when we teach this particular word, we notice that it's something the grammarians call a perfect tense, perfect passive, tetelestai. In one Greek word, we summarize three English or Aramaic words, it is finished, and in one Greek word we say it. That's a different way of talking than many of us normally talk. We don't normally go around saying, "It is finished." However, this weekend, Good Friday, leading into Easter, we notice that we do start to talk this way. For example, Easter morning, we say, "He is risen." One of my congregants, every Easter, would greet me on the steps of the church every year for I don't know how many years. She would say, "Christ is risen," and she would hang around and wait until I responded, "He is risen indeed." She wouldn't go away until I said those words, and I was happy to say them. But we don't just say traditionally, "Christ rose from the dead," we say, "He is risen." She would come back to me at coffee hour with a hard-boiled egg, put one in my hand and hold one herself. We would put them together and say, he is risen indeed. And in the same way, this tense now, in a very different circumstance, Christ didn't finish. It says he is, it is finished. Meaning, something has happened, yes, but that completion, that victory, still is good right now. Whatever he did is good even now. So what does it mean? To me, passionately, I want to say that what he has accomplished on the cross is something that we can claim and hold to. The victory over what? Sin and death. Something that we can lay claim to and call upon so that we may live our lives in the here and now, just more compassionately, more mercifully, more just, peaceful, loving of others because of what he has done and still is available to us today, the victory over sin and death. My wife and I watched the film adaptation the other night of Jane Eyre. And just to remind you, in that novel, young woman who much of her life has been very poor, suddenly becomes the heir of a great fortune. In one moment, she could go from bad to worse if she had begun to make bad choices about that money. But she, in her instance, starts to live amazingly generously towards others. I like to think that what he has accomplished would be something that we could live into, grow into, believe into, trust into in such a way that you and I may, as we take this to heart, live into, believe into it, and live more justly, more compassionately, more justly through Jesus Christ, who has said, "It is accomplished, it is finished." Let us pray. Lord, our faithful God, even in the bleak landscape of what we are told this day is all about, a day of death and crucifixion, let us hear that word that captures a note of triumph and victory over sin and death. It is finished. It is accomplished. The work that I came to do. And now may we live more closely to you, more justly towards our neighbors, and all those whom we have not met, but who are our brother and sister in the economy, the world that you would have us to dwell in, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Wondrous love is this, O my soul, O my soul. What wondrous love is this, O my soul? What wondrous love is this that caused the Lord of bliss to bear the dreadful curse for my soul, for my soul? To bear the dreadful curse for my soul. When I was sinking down, when I was sinking down, when I was sinking down beneath God's righteous frown, Christ laid aside his crown for my soul, Christ laid aside his crown for my soul. To God and to the Lamb I will sing, to God and to the Lamb I will sing. I will sing, while millions join the theme, I will sing. And when from death I'm free, I'll sing on, and when from death I'm free, I'll sing on. And when from death I'm free, sing God's love for me, and through eternity I'll sing on, and through eternity I'll sing on.
the seventh word from Luke. It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m, while the sun's light failed. And the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying out with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last. In the name of Jesus, amen. Into your hands, O Lord, I commend my spirit. We've been singing this now for a year. We've been praying this for a year. This refrain is part of our prayers from our night prayer service, part of the Office of Daily Prayer or Compline. We've been praying it 3, 4, 2 times a week. It is a bit of quiet prayer and song, confession and promise at the end of the day. And it helps us to lay aside the day that has been, letting go of our regrets and arguments, our worries, our tasks undone, and prepare ourselves to rest and renew. It's like brushing your teeth and washing your face before bed, except for your spirit, your soul. Into your hands, O Lord, I commend my spirit. At the end of the day, we give in to sleep, and unconsciousness takes us to this place where we are vulnerable and have no control. We've laid aside whatever protective armor, whatever compartments we use to get through the day. We lay aside our power suits or favorite outfits. There is no false cheer or bravado, no seeming indifference, no smiling through the pain. The walls we keep up to protect ourselves from harsh words have been broken down. In our weariness, we succumb to the day that has been, and as we rest, we are vulnerable. Our grief overwhelms us. Our insecurities ride rampant. Our guilt washes over us. Anxieties threaten. To whatever it is that we consciously or subconsciously push down when we're awake, that we box up or lay aside, we get ready to let sleep and night take us. We put ourselves into God's hands with these words, with this prayer of Jesus, of the psalmist. We commend ourselves to God's mighty hands that we would be safe through the night. These words of Jesus today from the cross are from Psalm 31. Even Jesus found comfort in these ancient prayers. They were part of his life, so much so that in his final moments, his final words before death, the words that came to him when nothing else would, when he was suffering and nailed to the cross and crowned with thorns, bleeding and dying, were the words and promises in this psalm. Jesus places himself at the end into the hands of the one he calls Father. Jesus was abandoned by all at the end. In this moment, Judas sold him out. The disciples were too scared to be there. His best friend and disciple, Peter, denies even knowing him. The crowds who surrounded him in life, who sought him as he taught and healed and fed, have turned against him. The same crowds that moments ago filled the street with hosannas and called him king now rang the air with "crucify him" and brought him to death. Yet Jesus knows there is one who will never turn him away. there is a place to be where he will never be shut out into your hands, O Lord. On this Good Friday, we linger here. We linger here in the dark as darkness overcame the land and the sun's light failed. We linger here because we have known in our own lives this darkness in ourselves, in our world. And it seems to be a God-forsaken place. It seems to be a place where God is not. And all the horrors and betrayal, torture, wrongful death, abandonment, in the lust for violence and unthinkable tragedy. Yet, here is Jesus in this place. It's not all happy healings and extra bread and fish. This day, this hour, we contemplate this God, this Jesus, who knows our darkness and suffering. We who have been baptized, we who have been marked with the same cross on our brow, the cross of Christ, know the promise that God will not abandon us in the darkness. God will not abandon us in our suffering. God will not abandon us even here. And so on this day, we learn the contours of this space so that we might know in our bones, in our being, through and through, what the life-giving love of God looks like and be assured that it is for us in this unbearable place, in this unknown landscape where life as we know it ends before something else begins. Jesus puts himself in the hands of the one who has known him and walked beside him before he was born. Jesus was often at prayer. He has spent a lifetime in conversation with the infinite knowing, the source of all. He was often at prayer, resting, gathering strength, healing, giving thanks. He prays as he breathes. These words come to him now. The presence of God is with him now, even at this hour. The 31st Psalm, which Jesus prays here, prays for deliverance, asks for a speedy rescue, that people know God will provide as a faithful God, recognizing God as a rock, a refuge, a strong fortress. This life of prayer for Jesus, for us, is an ongoing conversation, a continual forming of who we are in God, and it will not end here for Jesus. The psalm ends, "Love the Lord, all you saints. Be strong and let your heart take courage, all of you who wait for the Lord." Jesus shows us how to live and how to die, knowing that we are God's, knowing that we are carefully held in the hands of one who knows us completely and loves us to life, in death, and beyond. Let us pray. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend ourselves, resting in your everlasting hands, your truth laid bare on the cross, your truth that there is nothing we could not be forgiven, that we have value in your eyes, that even death cannot separate us. Your truth that our home, our resting place, our solace and strength is in you. Your truth restores and renews us and sets us free. We place ourselves in your hands, O God. Amen.
Crucified my Lord,
O Christ, Lamb of God, on this day we offer you the adoration of our hearts, for on the cross you reveal your suffering love. May we who celebrate the triumph of the cross receive the assurance of your victory over death and the hope of the resurrection, for you live and reign forever and ever. Amen.